In the 19th century, Cecilia Beaux, the first female full-time professor at PAFA, expressed that the hour was near when the term women in art will be as strange-sounding a topic as men in art would be now.
I think a lot of our art historical story focuses on the constraints that faced women artists, particularly in the 19th century, on the way that period ideas about womanhood, sexuality, professionalism, really put limits on what was possible for women artists. And those constraints were very real, as they remain real today. But what this exhibition does is focus on a group of women artists who showed remarkable ingenuity in navigating those social norms and all of those restrictions, and the ways that they creatively banded together, created networks, created friendships, that allowed them to carve out independent spaces in which they could live, work, and love as it benefited them.
In a time when women were denied access to many professional careers, their talent and drive had to be aided by family networks that brought them success through access to education and wealthy clients. In PAFA's first annual exhibition in 1811, director Joseph Hopkinson sought to include the products of female genius. Some of those works included paintings by Anna Claypool Peel, Margareta Angelica Peel, and Sarah Miriam Peel, the daughters of painter James Peel and nieces of the famed co-founder of PAFA, Charles Wilson Peel. Alternatively, the Wright family of sculptors was founded by a matriarch, Patience Lovell Wright, the first professional sculptor in the United States.
Patience Lovell Wright was forced into her artistry by necessity. She needed to support her family after her husband died. So it was really remarkable that a woman sculptor could support her whole family by her work. And she could not only work in the United States, what was the British colonies at the time, but travel back and forth between England and the United States, where she sculpted images of political leaders in Great Britain, the King and Queen, and she was the well-known predecessor of Madame Tussaud. George Washington wrote to Patience Wright in the 1780s and said that he really wanted to have his portrait done by her hand. In fact, it is thought that she was a spy in support of the revolutionary cause, and that messages might have actually been embodied in the back of her sculptures.
Aside from access to family networks for artistic training and patronage, women found opportunity to succeed via other routes, as copyists.
One of the keys to women's success in the early 19th century as artists was working as copyists. They just wouldn't have had the access, except through their family networks, to the higher genres of, say, portraiture or history painting. And there wasn't mass reproduced photography or printmaking in this time, so it really was an industry for artists to make copies. Two great examples of that in our exhibition are Harriet Canny Peel's copy of her husband's self-portrait and Jane Cooper Sully Darley's copy of her father's copy after Raphael, a beautiful Madonna. At this time, copying was one of the only areas where women could make a viable career. In the art world, we prize originality over everything else. So by doing that, we often neglect to look at the work of women copyists in the 18th and 19th century.
Around the mid-19th century, female artists had more paths to success through the new fields of etching, commercial illustration, and neoclassical sculpture. Advances in printmaking technologies and studio reproductions of sculptures provided an opportunity for women artists to help Americans have access to fine art reproductions for display in their homes. Female artists from this time also defied gender expectations, seeking success in Europe. There, artists like Harriet Hosmer could enjoy freedoms not available in the U.S., including the freedoms to engage in same-sex relationships and defy gender norms through fashion. But most importantly, their ability to receive expanded professional training.
Harriet Hosmer would create her original sculpture, and then she had a whole studio of male Italian artisans who would then carve copies of it for her. So it was a reversal of earlier women's practices where women were creating copies of artworks that men had thought up. Harriet Hosmer was the originary conceptual artists creating her sculptures, like Puck on a Toadstool.
Some, like Lily Martin Spencer, became mothers who supported their families with their art, while her husband stayed home to help run the household. Others forwent forming a traditionally gendered family for a professional career and opportunities abroad. Many female artists, like Mary Cassatt and Emily Sartain, left Philadelphia to study in Paris because they were not permitted to study the live human figure. It was in Paris that the next generation of professional American artists proved their mettle. While female students have been enrolled in PAFA since 1844 to study from the antique or plaster casts, in the 1860s they were still not permitted to study the live human figure. It was around this time that a group of female students, including Cassatt and Sartain, formed their own group to model for each other. By the 1880s, Cassatt's painting style had thoroughly aligned with the Impressionists, as she remained in Paris, while Sartain returned to the U.S. and became the respected principal of the Philadelphia School of Design for Women.
In the 1880s, American women were taking the Paris Salon by storm. Cecilia Beaux with Les Derniers Jours d'Enfance, and Anna Elizabeth Klumpke with In the Wash House. Beaux, Klumpke, Ellen Day Hale were all exhibiting their paintings at the Paris Salon and winning prizes and notoriety. Then the paintings would be sent across the Atlantic back to Philadelphia. In the Wash House was the first painting by a woman artist to win the prestigious Temple Gold Medal. This was the prize for the best painting by any artist at the PAFA annual exhibition. The subject matter of Anna Elizabeth Klumpke's painting is women working together, enjoying their time, they're smiling, they're warm. When we stand in front of the painting, we're almost brought into their jovial working community. It's a remarkably intimate painting for such a large painting. In this time period, with Klumpke staying in Paris and becoming the life partner of the famous French painter Rosa Bonheur, and Cecilia Beaux coming back from Paris and becoming the first woman full-time instructor at PAFA, this creates a model for the next generation of women artists to actually have careers as professional women artists, like Elizabeth Sparhawk Jones, who studied with Cecilia Beaux and becomes an incredibly successful artist in her own right in the early 20th century. And she, in turn, as a professional woman artist, focuses on other professional women, not only nannies, but shop girls who work at Wanamaker's department store and sell products to wealthy women. She's really interested in the intersection between the classes and how women make a living in this time period where women are actually leaving the home and making their way in the professional world.
The Progressive Era, a period of social activism and political reform across the U.S., ushered in new educational opportunities for women artists. This period coincided with growth in the professionalization of certain fields for women, such as popular illustration and arts education, and the movement for universal women's suffrage. In 1895, Cecilia Beaux became the first full-time female professor, not only at PAFA, but also at any coeducational art school in the U.S. As one of the U.S.'s top portraitists, Beaux was also famous for her role as a teacher. Her educational legacy can be tied to Violet Oakley, one of her most successful students, who not only becomes the second full-time female professor at PAFA, but also becomes one of the nation's first female muralists. This was also the time that African-American women began studying at PAFA, including the painter and sculptor Mae Howard Jackson. Jackson was the first African-American woman to receive a full scholarship to attend PAFA, where she studied both sculpture and painting.
Mae Howard Jackson and Laura Wheeler Waring are two of the first African-American women to study at PAFA. And though they were both from Philadelphia, they are often associated with New York because of their involvement with the Harlem Renaissance movement. So what's fascinating about this exhibition and the work in the collection is that we are able to focus on both the uptown and downtown scene in New York going on at the same time. So many people might be familiar with the names Georgia O'Keeffe and Florine Stettheimer, who are associated with modernism and the downtown art scene. But at the same time, there is a flourishing art scene uptown in Harlem. And two of the leading artists of that movement are actually from Philadelphia and studied at PAFA.
As Jackson and Waring molded the uptown art scene in Harlem, their counterparts downtown were Georgia O'Keeffe and Florine Stettheimer. Born into a wealthy New York family, Florine Stettheimer studied at the Art Student League before obtaining further training in Munich and Paris. Upon the outbreak of World War I, her family returned to New York and quickly came to dominate the city's progressive art circles.
In Stettheimer's Picnic at Bedford Hills, she's showing us a scene of a picnic out in the suburbs of New York with her artist friends. And that is emblematic of the greater access to subject matter, as well as free-floating style, so wonderfully captured in Stettheimer's paintings.
O'Keeffe was working in the same progressive circles of New York City. Her mature style of modernism was influenced less by American folk art and more by the international modernism of the Stieglitz Circle, of which she was the only female member.
At the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th, as women have access to more professional development, they have access to more genres of art. Women have more access and independence to being out in public parks, to going to public beaches, or traveling to the mountains. These are things that they would have not had access to in the earlier 19th century. But with the advent of modernism, more professional independence, and working towards the right to vote, women's subject matter expands both into landscape and into cityscapes. In PAFA's collection, we not only have wonderful urban scenes of New York, like Hilda Belker's painting of an Easter window, but we have a wonderful group of urban scenes by the artist known as the Philadelphia Ten.
Modernists like Hilda Belcher and Nancy Ferguson focused on cityscapes, a popular new subject for the independent women artists of the early 20th century. Ferguson attended both PAFA and the Philadelphia School of Design for Women, where she studied under the leadership of Emily Sartain. She was a member of the Philadelphia Ten, a group of women modernist painters who exhibited together from 1917 to 1945.
The centrality of Philadelphia and PAFA specifically in this exhibition story was also very exciting for us to highlight. Almost everything in this project comes out of our permanent collection. And so what we've really been able to do is set up Philadelphia as the locus of women's independent thinking, creative problem solving, and networking in the 18th and 19th centuries in ways that might surprise people. There is some scholarly ambiguity around some of the details of the personal relationships between the women artists in this exhibition. We were very excited to be able to highlight some of the often ignored and even erased stories of the contributions of early queer women artists. And I think what's really inspiring is if you walk through this show, you can see all of the ways in which these women busted through doors that were meant to be shut to them, and then made the choice to hold them open for the women coming up behind them, not just the generation of women that they were peers with, but for generations after them, and use as a model for how we might persevere in a world that still has some pretty restrictive social norms.